Penguin Audio presents In the Woods by Tana French, read by Stephen Crossley. From A Bright Room Called Day by Tony Kushner. Probably just somebody's nasty black poodle. But I've always wondered, what if it really was him, and he decided I wasn't worth it? Prologue. Picture a summer stolen whole from some coming-of-age film set in small-town 1950s. This is none of Ireland's subtle seasons mixed for a connoisseur's palate, watercolour nuances within a pinch-sized range of cloud and soft rain. This is summer full-throated and extravagant in a hot, pure silkscreen blue. This summer explodes on your tongue tasting of chewed blades of long grass, your own clean sweat, Marie biscuits with butter squirting through the holes, and shaken bottles of red lemonade picnicked in treehouses. It tingles on your skin with BMX wind in your face, ladybug feet up your arm. It packs every breath full of mown grass and billowing wash lines. It chimes and fountains with bird calls, bees, leaves, and football bounces and skipping chants. One, two, three. This summer will never end. It starts every day with a shower of Mr. Whippy notes and your best friend's knock at the door. Finishes it with long, slow twilight and mothers silhouetted in doorways calling you to come in, through the bats shrilling among the black lace trees. This is every summer, decked in all its best glory. Picture an orderly little maze of houses on a hill, only a few miles from Dublin. Someday the government declared this will be a buzzing marvel of suburban vitality, a plan-perfect solution to overcrowding and poverty and every urban ill. For now, it's a few handfuls of cloned semi-detacheds, still new enough to look startled and gauche on their hillside. While the government rhapsodized about McDonald's and multi-screens, a few young families, escaping from the tenements and outdoor toilets that went unmentioned in 1970s Ireland, or dreaming big back gardens and hopscotch roads for their children, or just buying as close to home as a teacher's or bus driver's salary would let them, packed rubbish bags and bumped along a two-track path, grass and daisies growing down the middle, to their mint new start. That was 10 years ago, and the vague strobe light dazzle of chain stores and community centres conjured up under infrastructure has so far failed to materialise. Minor politicians occasionally bellow in the Doyle unreported about shady land deals. Farmers still pasture cows across the road, and night flicks on only a sparse constellation of lights on the neighbouring hillsides. Behind the estate, where the someday plans show the shopping centre and the neat little park, spreads a square mile and who knows how many centuries of wood. Move closer. Follow the three children scrambling over the thin membrane of brick and mortar that holds the wood back from the semi-Ds. Their bodies have the perfect economy of latency. They are streamlined and unself-conscious, paired to light flying machines. White tattoos, lightning bolt, star, A, flash where they cut band-aids into shapes and let the sun brown around them. A flag of white blonde hair flies out. Toe hold, knee on the wall, up and over and gone. The wood is all flicker and murmur and illusion. Its silence is a pointillist conspiracy of a million tiny noises, rustles, flurries, nameless truncated shrieks. Its emptiness teems with secret life, scurrying just beyond the corner of your eye. Careful. Bees zip in and out of cracks in the leaning oak. Stop to turn any stone and strange larvae will wriggle irritably while an earnest thread of ants twines up your ankle. In the ruined tower, someone's abandoned stronghold, nettles thick as your wrist, sees between the stones, and at dawn, rabbits bring their kittens out from the foundations to play on ancient graves. These three children own the summer. They know the wood as surely as they know the micro-landscapes of their own grazed knees. put them down blindfolded in any dell or clearing, and they could find their way out without putting a foot wrong. This is their territory, and they rule it wild and lordly as young animals. They scramble through its trees and hide and seek in its hollows all the endless day long, and all night in their dreams. They're running into legend, into sleepover stories and nightmares parents never hear. Down the faint lost paths you would never find alone, skidding round the tumbled stone walls, they stream calls and shoelaces behind them like comet trails. And who is it waiting on the riverbank with his hands in the willow branches, whose laughter tumbles swaying from a branch high above? Whose is the face in the undergrowth, in the corner of your eye, built of light and leaf shadow, there and gone in a blink? These children will not be coming of age, this or any other summer. This August will not ask them to find hidden reserves of strength and courage as they confront the complexity of the adult world and come away sadder and wiser and bonded for life. This summer has other requirements for them. 1. What I warn you to remember is that I'm a detective. Our relationship with truth is fundamental but cracked, refracting confusingly like fragmented glass. It's the core of our careers, the endgame of every move we make, and we pursue it with strategies painstakingly constructed of lies and concealment and every variation on deception. The truth is the most desirable woman in the world, and we are the most jealous lovers, reflexively denying anyone else the slightest glimpse of her. We betray her routinely, spending hours and days stupor deep in lies, and then turn back to her holding out the lover's ultimate Mobius strip. But I only did it because I love you so much. I have a pretty knack for imagery, especially the cheap facile kind. Don't let me fool you into seeing us as a bunch of parfy genteel knights galloping off in doublets after Lady Truth on her white palfrey. What we do is crude, crass, and nasty. A girl gives her boyfriend an alibi for the evening when we suspect him of robbing a North Side centra and stabbing the clerk. I flirt with her at first, telling her I can see why he would want to stay home when he's got her. She's peroxided and greasy, with the flat, stunted features of generations of malnutrition, and privately, I'm thinking that if I were her boyfriend, I would be relieved to trade her even for a hairy cellmate named Razor. Then I tell her we've found marked bills from the till in his classy white tracksuit bottoms, and he's claiming that she went out that evening and gave them to him when she got back. I do it so convincingly, with such delicate cross-hatching of discomfort and compassion at her man's betrayal, that finally her faith in 4 shared years disintegrates like a sandcastle. And through tears and snot, while her man sits with my partner in the next interview room saying nothing except, "Fuck off, I was home with Jackie," she tells me everything from the time he left the house to the details of his sexual shortcomings. Then I pat her gently on the shoulder and give her a tissue and a cup of tea and a statement sheet. This is my job, and you don't go into it, or if you do, you don't last, without some natural affinity for its priorities and demands. What I'm telling you, before you begin my story, is this. 2 things. I crave truth, and I lie. This is what I read in the file the day after I made detective. I will come back to this story again and again in any number of different ways. A poor thing possibly, but mine own. This is the only story in the world that nobody but me will ever be able to tell. On the afternoon of Tuesday, August the 14th, 1984, 3 children, Jermaine, Jamie, Eleanor Rowan, Adam Robert Ryan and Peter Joseph Savage, all aged 12, were playing in the road where their houses stood, in the small County Dublin town of Knocknaree. As it was a hot, clear day, many residents were in their gardens, and numerous witnesses saw the children at various times during the afternoon, balancing along the wall at the end of the road, riding their bicycles, and swinging on a tyre swing. Knocknaree was at that time very sparsely developed, and a sizeable wood adjoined the estate, separated from it by a 5-foot wall. Around 3 p.m, the three children left their bicycles in the Savage's front garden, telling Mrs. Angela Savage, who was in the garden hanging washing on the line, that they were going to play in the wood. They did this often, and knew that part of the wood well, so Mrs. Savage wasn't worried that they would become lost. Peter had a wristwatch, and she told him to be home by 6:30 for his tea. This conversation was confirmed by her next-door neighbour, Mrs. Mary Therese Corry, and several witnesses saw the children climbing over the wall at the end of the road and going into the wood. When Peter Savage had not returned by 6:45, his mother called around to the mothers of the other two children, assuming he had gone to one of their houses. None of the children had returned. Peter Savage was normally reliable, but the parents didn't at that point become worried. They assumed that the children had become absorbed in a game and forgotten to check the time. At approximately 7:05, Mrs. Savage went around to the wood by the road, walked a little way in, and called the children. She heard no answer, and neither saw nor heard anything to indicate any person was present in the wood. She returned home to serve tea to her husband, Mr. Joseph Savage, and their four younger children. After tea, Mr. Savage and Mr. John Ryan, Adam Ryan's father, went a little further into the wood, called the children, and again received no response. At 8:25, when it was beginning to grow dark, the parents became seriously worried that the children might have become lost, and Miss Alicia Rowan, Germaine's mother, a single parent, who had a telephone, rang the police. A search of the wood began. There was at this point some fear that the children might have run away. Miss Rowan had decided that Germaine was to go to boarding school in Dublin, remaining there during the week and returning to Knocknaree at weekends. She had been scheduled to leave 2 weeks later, and all three children had been very upset at the thought of being separated. However, a preliminary search of the children's rooms revealed that no clothing, money, or personal items appeared to be missing. Germaine's piggy bank, in the form of a Russian doll, contained 5.85 and was intact. At 10:20 p.m, a policeman with a torch found Adam Ryan in a densely wooded area near the centre of the wood, standing with his back and palms pressed against a large oak tree. His fingernails were digging into the trunk so deeply that they had broken off in the bark. He appeared to have been there for some time, but hadn't responded to the searcher's calling. He was taken to hospital. The dog unit was called in and tracked the two missing children to a point not far from where Adam Ryan had been found. There, the dogs became confused and lost the scent. When I was found, I was wearing blue denim shorts, a white cotton t-shirt, white cotton socks, and white lace-up running shoes. The shoes were heavily blood-stained, the socks less heavily. Later analysis of the staining pattern showed that the blood had soaked through the shoes from the inside outwards. It had soaked through the socks in lesser concentrations from the outside in. The implication was that the shoes had been removed and blood had spilled into them. Sometime later, when it had begun to coagulate, the shoes had been replaced on my feet, thus transferring blood to the socks. The t-shirt showed four parallel tears between 3 and 5 inches in length, running diagonally across the back from the mid-left shoulder blade to the right back ribs. I was uninjured except for some minor scratches on my calves, splinters, later found to be consistent with the wood of the oak tree under my fingernails, and a deep abrasion on each kneecap, both beginning to form scabs. There was some uncertainty as to whether the grazes had been made in the wood or not. As a younger child, Aideen Watkins, aged 5, who had been playing in the road, stated that she had seen me fall from a wall earlier that day, landing on my knees. However, her statement varied with retelling and was not considered reliable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.